the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says in the hadith sahih, ala inna fil jasadi mudgha idha salahat salaha al jasadu kullu wa idha fasadat fasada al jasadu kullu. That indeed in the human body, ala inna fil jasadi mudgha, in the human body there's a vessel. This vessel is so important, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, إِذَا صَلَحَتْ, that if this vessel is clean and it's pure, the whole body is clean and pure. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if this whole body is evil, وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ, and if this body, if this vessel, this organ, if it's fasad, if it's evil and corrupt and bad and it's full of diseases, then likewise, fasad al-jasadu kullu, then the whole body is evil and corrupt. The whole body is evil and corrupt and bad and contagious and it's full of disease. The whole body is contagious and full of diseases just because of the disease and the corruption of the heart. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the people who have evil hearts. A man, a sahabi, went to Salama radiallahu anha, and he asked her, ما كان أكثر دعاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذ كان عندك. O Salama, what was most of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he used to pray when he was with you? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had many wives. So here we see the anxiousness and the eagerness of the Sahaba. May Allah be pleased and have mercy on all of them. They go to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they ask for ilm, they ask for knowledge. So this companion goes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asks, goes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's wife, Salama radiallahu anha, and says, what was most of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was with you? What was most of his dua? So she says, kana aktharu du'a'ih ya muqallib al-qulub thabbit qalbi ala dinik. So she says that most of the time, most of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, O Allah, the one who changes the heart, Thabbit Qalbi, make my heart firm on your deen. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, O Allah, the one who changes the heart. Sometimes it leans to good, and sometimes it goes to good, and then sometimes it goes to bad. So the Prophet ﷺ says, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, O Allah, the one who changes the heart, who turns the heart. Thabbit qalbi, make my heart firm on your deen. So when Salama radiallahu anha, when she heard this, when she heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam constantly repeating this dua, she said, Ya Rasulallah, ما أكثر دعاءك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلب على دينك. So she says, Ya Rasulullah, I hear you constantly repeating. I hear you constantly saying this dua again and again and again. I hear you say this dua, يا مقلب القلوب. O Allah, the one who turns the hearts, turn my heart, make my heart firm on your deen. He says, Ya Umm Salama, he says, Laysa ala adamiyin, or there's not a human soul, illa wa qalbuhu bayna usba'ini min asabi ar-Rahman, in sha'a aqama wa in sha'a azaga. He says, Salama, there's not a human soul, except that there's not a human body, there's not a Ibn Adam, there's not a son of Adam, except his soul is in the fingers of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wants, he guides that soul. And if Allah wants, he misguides them. If Allah wants, He guides that soul. The Prophet ﷺ says, there's not a human being except his soul is turned, is changed in the fingers of Ar-Rahman. يُقَلِّبُهَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. We affirm fingers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that suit His majesty. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet ﷺ says that there's not a human being except his heart is changed, is turned in the hand of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he wants, he guides that human being. And if he wants, he misguides them. Because brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet, when a heart is guided and is free of desires and it seeks none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that heart is good and it's clean and it's free for its creator, then this heart reaches all good. It loves for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It hates for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It sleeps for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It moves for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every direction, every instant of this heart's work, every instant that it pumps blood, it pumps it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like a sponge that takes up any liquid that is placed on top of it. Likewise, the heart of a believer, the heart of a Muslim, the heart of a good Muslim, it takes in the light of the Quran and the Sunnah. And in contrast to that, people that have diseases of the heart, jealousy, hate, spite, envy, these are some of the diseases that we have in the heart. And then on top of that, the biggest and the most dangerous disease, which is preceding the desires of your soul, of your body, over the commandments of Allah and the commandments of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another hadith, before we talk about how the companions and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how they took the affairs of the heart seriously. If we look in the Quran and if we look in the Sunnah, we'll find also that also other prophets took the heart seriously. Allah mentions to us the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, where he says, إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. In this part of the ayah, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he talks and he debates his nation on worshipping, on committing shirk. It's a famous story that we've all read time and time again in the Quran. So he debates them and he talks to them and he has a dialogue with them that maybe they'll come to their senses. Then at the end of his dialogue, Ibrahim alayhi salam mentions the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed him. And then he says, on the day of judgment, no money and no children are going to help you. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. On the day of Qiyamah, nothing is going to help you. Nothing is going to help you. Not your son, not your daughter, not the money that you had. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except the one who stands in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his heart is salim, his heart is pure, his heart has got peace, his heart is good. Nothing will help you on the day of judgment except when your heart is in that state. There's another hadith, a beautiful hadith in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, Ya Shaddad, إذا رأيت الناس قد اقتنزوا الذهب والفضة فاقتنز هؤلاء الكلمات. O Shaddad, hear the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. This hadith encompasses so much good. This hadith encompasses so much good that it needs a lesson just to talk about it. But just to briefly relate it to our topic, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, Ya Shaddad, O Shaddad, when you see man treasuring gold and silver, hold on to the treasures of the following statements. Wallahi al-Azim, yes, if we look and ponder over this hadith, few statements, about 6 or 7 statements in this hadith, if we ponder over them, they encompass all good. After the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our success after the will of Allah and His guidance and His mercy over us. Okay, if we implement this hadith, inshallah, we'll be successful in this world and the hereafter. So the Prophet says, Ya Shaddad, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ قَدْ اِقْتَنَزُوا الذَّهَبَ وَالْفِضَّةِ فَاقْتَنِزْ هَؤُلَاءِ الْكَلِمَاتِ O Shaddad, if you see people treasuring gold and silver, treasure the following statements. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allahumma, say, O Shaddad, Allahumma inni as'aluka thabata fil amr. O Allah, I ask you to make me firm in my deen. Wal azimata ala rushd. And I ask you to give me the willpower to do everything that's good. Because how many people, they want to do good. Good is in front of them, but they have no willpower to do it. Good is in front of them, but they have no willpower to do it. How many people, they have so much money in their bank account. There's nothing that's stopping them from transferring or from giving sadaqah, except for example, him going to his bank account, the ATM, and taking out money from the ATM. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give him the willpower and the hidayah to do it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says here, وَأَسْأَلُكَ الْعَزِيمَةَ عَلَى الرُّشْدِ That, oh Allah, give me the willpower to do everything that's good. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ مُوجِبَاتِ رَحْمَتِكَ Then, oh Allah, I ask you, oh Shaddad, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the ability. وَأَسْأَلُكَ مُوجِبَاتِ رَحْمَتِكَ Then, oh Allah, give me what's going to give me your mercy. Give me what's going to make your mercy on me wajib. Give me what's going to attain, what's going to give me the ability to get your mercy. And then he says, وَعَزَائِمَ مَغْفِرَتِكَ Oh Allah, give me what's going to help me attain your maghfirah. And then he says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ شُكْرَ نِعْمَتِكَ Oh Allah, give me the ability to be grateful over the blessings that you have given me. How many people, they eat, sleep, they showered with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the day till the night. In fact, even when they're sleeping and they're dreaming, they're in the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many people are neglected from the blessing of sleep? Sleep, they need tablets. If it wasn't for sleeping tablets and injections and help from the doctors, they can't sleep. How many people are showered from day to night with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they don't even say Alhamdulillah? And this is advice that the Prophet ﷺ gave Shaddad, and he told him that when you see people holding on to the treasures of gold and silver, hold on to the treasures of these statements. 5 or 6 simple statements, and the Prophet ﷺ gives it to him, one after the other. وَأَسْأَلُكَ شُكْرَ نِعْمَتِكَ Then he says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ لِسَانًا صَادِقًا O Shaddad, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you a firm tongue, a tongue that you use to speak truth, a tongue that you use to speak good. And in another hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ما ضمن لي ما بين لحييه ورجليه ضمنت له الجنة. That the one who guarantees me, the one who can guarantee that he will save himself from what's between his beard and his mustache, i.e. the tongue, and what's between his thighs, the Prophet ﷺ will guarantee you Jannah. In one hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ says that if you can guarantee the Prophet ﷺ, and if you can try and control what's between your chin and your mustache, your tongue, and you can also safeguard what's between your thighs, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is guaranteeing you Jannah. He says, Dhaman. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this hadith, he says, Ya Shaddad, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you see people holding on to the treasures of gold and silver, hold on to the treasures of the following statement. And amongst the statement is, with Shaddad ibn Awi, the Prophet told him, وَاسْأَلُكَ شُكْرَ نِعْمَتِكَ. I ask Allah, oh Allah, I ask you to give me the ability to say hamd, to be grateful for your blessings. And then the Prophet says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ قَلْبًا سَلِيمًا. I ask, O Shaddad, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a clean heart. Because when a heart is clean, it loves only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It frees itself from the diseases of the heart, which many of us today have. And then the Prophet says, وَاسْأَلُكَ مِنْ خَيْرِ مَا تَعْلَمْ. And then the Prophet says, and ask Allah for whatever is good. Ask Allah to give you whatever is good that He knows. And this is a point that we need to ponder on now. When you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you good that He knows is good for you. And this was the understanding of the Sahaba and the Prophets. They asked Allah for khair. Because sometimes you want something and you raise your hands and you ask Allah and it's not good for you. And when you don't get it, you get upset at why isn't Allah giving it to me? Why doesn't He answer my call? For example, some people, they say, I want money. I just want to own my house. Maybe owning your house is going to be bad for you. So the Prophet instructed and advised Shaddad that ask Allah to give you good what He knows is good for you. Ask Allah to give you good and He knows it's good for you. Then he says, وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا تَعْلَمْ. And I seek refuge from Allah. I seek refuge from you in Allah in whatever I don't know. Because you don't know. You don't know what's bad. You can be sleeping in your house and there could be bad there. And you don't know it. You can have an enemy in your house and you don't know it's there. You can have an enemy at work and you don't know it's there. And you don't seek refuge from Allah in that enemy, in that bad. So here the Prophet instructs and advises him. Say, وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا تَعْلَمْ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُكَ بِمَا تَعْلَمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. And I seek repentance, I seek pardon, I make tawbah. Okay, on whatever of my sins that you know, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. Verily, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are the one that knows the unseen. A beautiful hadith. Treasures from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And amongst these treasures, look how he asked Shaddad to ask for a clean heart. He didn't ask him to say, give him good health. He didn't ask him to ask Allah to give him food. He didn't ask him to ask Allah to give him clean water. Yes, these are all blessings that we need. But if you ponder over this hadith after the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His rahmah and His mercy and His hidayah, if we have to implement this hadith, inshallah we will be successful. This is how the Sahaba understood the importance of a clean heart. And then, not only did the Prophets ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for clean hearts, even the Sahaba, the best generation after the Prophets, the people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to accompany the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says in the Quran, هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ وَأُخَرٌ مُتَشَابِهَاتٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, He talks about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the book on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the book, there are ayat that are clear. Ayatu muhkamat. They are clear. Hunna ummul kitab, and they are the foundation of the book. And then in the book, along with the ayat that are clear, you've got ayat that are mutashabihat, that are not that clear. They're not clear to some people or so many people. So the people that use the clear ayat to understand the unclear ayat, they are the people that have guidance. They've acquired the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people that use the muhkamat over the mutashabih, they have acquired the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the people that use the clear proofs, and they use these clear proofs to understand the proofs that are not so clear, they've acquired the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are people with diseases in their hearts. Allah with his decree and his mercy, and Allah with his wisdom, he chose to misguide them and mislead them. These people take the opposite stance. They take the mutashabih, they take the ayat that are not clear, or not clear to many people, or so many people, and they use them to interpret the muhkamat, the ayat that are clear. Just like the khawarij. Then Allah says, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْ. That the people who have misguidance, and the people who Allah has misled, this is what they do. They take the ayat that are not clear, and they use them to translate the ayat that are clear. What did the Muslims do after this? They said, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدِ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَابِ وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَابِ. So the pious people, they turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they supplicated to him, and they said, رَبَّنَا, O Allah, O our Lord, لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا. Do not mislead, do not misguide our souls after you've given them guidance, after you've guided our souls, after you've guided our heart. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَابِ. Verily, you are the one who gives all things. O slaves of Allah, if you understand what has just been said, and we understand the importance of having a clean heart, what is the remedy? We understand the problem. How do we save ourselves from being victims of this problem that might cost us our hereafter? There's a few points. If you really want to have a clean heart and you want to try and sort the problem out, there's a few points that we need to take into consideration, we need to take into account. That inshallah, after the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the will of Allah, inshallah Allah will give us clean hearts. And maybe inshallah, after his mercy and guidance and his rahmah, we'll be successful. So if you want a clean heart, pay attention to the following points. The first one is to ponder and contemplate over the Quran. If you want to sort your heart out, if you've got the disease, if you're a victim of jealousy, if you are jealous to other people and you've got diseases of the heart, the first thing you need to do is contemplate and ponder over the Quran. Because there's not an ailment, there's not a remedy for the diseases that are out there except Allah mentioned them in the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah says in the Quran, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. That has the time not come? أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبَهُمْ. That has the time not come for the people of belief? أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ. So that they can ponder and feel the Quran, وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ, and what it has brought in truth. وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. And lest they should be like the people before them. Lest they should be like the people before them, time was prolonged and their hearts became hardened. And Allah says in another part of the Quran, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. That do they not ponder over the Quran, or are their hearts locked? So if you find your heart locked, start pondering over the Quran. Contemplate over the Quran. Because this Quran that we read every day, it's shifa, it's cure. And Allah described it as huda. Allah described it as light. And it's also guidance. So pondering over the Quran will help you have a clean heart. Pondering over the Quran will help you have a clean heart. The second point is to stay away from sins. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith which is authentic, sahih, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنْ إِذَا أَذْنَبْ كَانَتْ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدَى فِي قَلْبِهِ فَإِنْ تَابَ وَاسْتَغْفَرْ وَنَزَعْ سَقَلَتْ قَلْبُهِ. That when a believer commits a sin, when a believer commits a sin, a black dot is put into his heart. If he repents and he refrains from committing this sin, his heart is polished, goes back to being white again. Or it goes back to being without the dot. فَإِنْ زَادْ زَادَتْ. But if he goes back to that sin, okay, the dot is put there again. And when he commits that sin again, the dot gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, حَتَّى تَعْلُوَ قَلْبَهِ فَذَلِكَ هُوَ الرَّانَ الَّذِي قَالَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ كَلَّا بِالْرَانَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ. When he commits the sin, that dot is put in his heart, and when he commits it again, it gets bigger and bigger, bigger, until it covers the heart. When it covers the heart, this is where the Prophet ﷺ translated, he interpreted, كَلَّا بَالْرَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ, that verily, ran has covered their hearts. And the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَحْرُمُ الرِّزْقَ بِذَنْبٍ يُصِيبُهُ, that a man will be denied of sustenance because of a sin that he's committed. A man will be denied of sustenance. So if you're, for example, if you're a stockbroker and you're going to the market, and Allah has decreed that you're going to, for example, earn 10,000 riyals, but because on the way to work you committed a sin, you'll be deprived of that blessing. Authentic hadith, sahih, on the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَحْرِمُ الرِّزْقِ بِذَنْبٍ يُصِيبُ, that a man is denied rizq, he's denied sustenance over a sin that he commits. So if you want to sort out your heart, stay away from sins. The third point, and there are many points, but just because we don't have time, I'm going to mention about four. The third point is to not break your covenants, your oaths, your promises. The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says in the Quran, فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ لَعَنَّاهُمْ وَجْعَلْنَا قُلُوبَهُمْ قَاسِيَةً, that the Jews, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a pact and a covenant and an oath with them, they broke it, and they didn't adhere to it. So Allah, what did Allah do? لَعَنَّاهُمْ وَجْعَلْنَا قُلُوبَهُمْ قَاسِيَةً. We cursed them and we made their hearts hard. We hardened their hearts. And when your heart is hard, you're further away from benefiting from the Quran and the Sunnah. You're further away from benefiting from the Quran and the Sunnah. Because to benefit from the Quran and the Sunnah, you need a heart that's free. You need a heart that's free, that only sees Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in the hadith, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ كَانَ مُنَافِقًا خَالِصًا إِذَا حَدَّثَ كَذَبْ. That three categories, if you see them in a person, he's a munafiq. How the scholars say, not a munafiq like the hypocrites who are going to go into the basement of the fire, like Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. The nifaq has two categories. You've got nifaq i'tiqadi, where you believe, where you conceal hatredness, you conceal hate over Islam. Now you're a munafiq, even if you have a beard and you wear a thawb. If you die like this, Allah will put you on the base of the fire, the hottest part of the fire of Jahannam, because Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. That the hypocrites, the people that concealed hate and animosity for the Quran and the Sunnah, Allah will put them on the lowest level of the fire of Jahannam, which is the most severe, where the punishment is most severe. But there's another type of nifaq, which we call nifaqun amali, okay? Nifaqun amali, where you do nifaq just on your by actions. This is minor compared to the first one. So the Prophet ﷺ says there's three categories of a munafiq, three characteristics. If you see them in a person, know that he's a munafiq. One of them is if he talks, he lies. You make a promise with your brother, fulfill it. You have an oath, fulfill it. You said something, fulfill it. Stand by your word. Because the Jews, they made a covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They broke their covenant. Allah made their heart. Allah cursed them and made their heart hard. The fourth point is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you a good heart. Wallahi al-azim, the best man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who Allah forgave his past sins and previous sins and all his sins, the one who Allah forgave and gave victory to, the best man to walk on the face of this earth, he will say, Allahumma ihdi qalbi wa saddid lisani waslul sakhimata qalbi. He would say, oh Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would raise his hand and say, oh Allah, guide my heart. وَسَدِّدْ لِسَانِي, make my tongue good, so I use it in what's gonna give me good. وَسْلُلْ سَخِيمَتْ قَلْبِي, and take away the jealousy that I have in my heart. Take away the jealousy that I have in my heart. Wallahi al-azim, we need this advice more than the companions. Especially today when people have become so materialistic and we become distant from the Quran and the Sunnah, we need this advice. To ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you want to sort out your heart, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even in English, oh Allah, give me a clean heart. If you want to stand on the Day of Judgment, like what Ibrahim alayhi salam said, where nothing will help you except your heart, ask Allah every day before you go to sleep. Every day ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you a clean heart.